Assalamu alaikum and welcome to Health in Islam. I'm your host, Ismaeel Chartier, and with me is Dr. Hassan Hamdi, professor of internal medicine in the tropics at Ain Shams University. Today's topic is about fasting with diabetes in the month of Ramadan. This is a topic of huge importance to Muslims all over the world who have diabetes and want to know medically if they can fulfill this pillar of their faith. So we're going to jump right into it, swing for the fences and try to knock this one out of the park. Doctor, I've read something about what's called the Ramadan 3D triangle. Could you elaborate on this a little bit for us?
I prefer to clarify what you mean by 3Ds.
The 3Ds, drug regimen adjustment, diet control, and daily activity.
Oh, why this is restricted to Ramadan? This is a policy of diabetic management all over the year. No. Ramadan and through all the year.
Through all the year.
This is the 3Ds we rely upon on management of diabetes. But they have special importance in Ramadan. So I agree with you with those 3Ds. May I use this term after that in my lessons? 3Ds, diet, exercise, or you called it the daily activity and drugs, mm-hmm. are the main pillars of controlling diabetes. They acquire a special importance in Ramadan. Why? Generally, and especially in Ramadan, we in diabetes rely upon what we call rendezvous. What's rendezvous? That's to say, the adjusted time of meeting the insulin, whether it is endogenously produced or exogenously provided by an injection, with the sugar entering the blood from a meal. If insulin meets sugar at the prepared time the action of insulin will occur, the patient will be euglycemic, he will benefit from drugs, he will benefit from diet. But if insulin enters the blood before or after glucose, there will no action. If insulin goes before glucose will go down, what we call hypoglycemia. Mm-hmm. If it goes after glucose, there will be a period of hyperglycemia, increasing glucose in the blood, in which the patient is symptomatic and the patient will develop complication. So adjusting diet, drugs, and daily activity is the main cornerstone for controlling diabetes in Ramadan and
out of Ramadan.
Yeah.
How would you judge whether to grant medical permission to fast Ramadan? If you had a patient come to you and they said, you know his whole case history, how would you judge if this person is fit to fast this blessed month?
This is a very important question. It's very great responsibility to decide. Roughly, away from sophistication or certain specified figures, we classify diabetic patients as regards Ramadan fasting into five main categories. Number one is the patient whose blood sugar is adjusted on the first D only, that is to say diet, mm-hmm. and daily activity. He is not receiving medications whatsoever. This patient is allowed to fast, but not only allowed to fast, he is advised to fast, because diet is the main regulator of his diabetes. I have a diabetic patient who takes regular medication, either orally, tablets, mm-hmm. or insulin injections. This is a more advanced degree of diabetes than a person who depends on diet regulations alone. Who takes regular pills once daily, he is advised to fast and to take the same medication, but at night.
Mom, at the time of iftar.
At a time of iftar. The same dose. Hmm. Okay?
No.
Right. Yes. If a person is taking regular medicines in the form of pills twice daily, he will take the same in iftar and half the dose in sahur, simply because I don't want his glucose to go down during fasting.
Mm-hmm.
Now we describe three categories: patient on diet only, patient on pills once daily, patient on pills twice daily.
Mm-hmm.
Now we have a patient who takes insulin. It's a more advanced stage of diabetes than who takes pills. Again, this is further subclassified into two categories: one who takes insulin once daily and the other who takes insulin twice daily. Who takes insulin twice daily is not advised to fast.
Not at all.
No. His blood sugar will be disturbed, his health may be affected. Islam does not permit that. A person who takes insulin once daily, if this once daily insulin does not exceed 40 units, he is allowed to fast and to take this medication at the time of iftar. If the single dose is more than 40 units, it's a stage of severe diabetes and he's not advised to fast.
Leave it alone.
Fortunately, nowadays we have some newer medications of insulin, what's called peakless insulin and what's called ultra short insulin, and they help us so much to adjust blood sugar without attacks of hypoglycemia, which is very dangerous and may endanger life. So I want, if you permit me, to warn the patient from hypoglycemia and to show them what are the symptoms of hypoglycemia, how a patient know that he is now hypoglycemic and he must end his fasting.
Yeah, that was one of my questions I was going to ask. Is you must recognize that I think it's dehydration and hypoglycemia.
Yeah.
These two things, when you're fasting with diabetes, can lead to huge complications. So if you could explain what those are, both dehydration and hypoglycemia, this will help our
dehydration viewers. Is loss of fluids. A thirsty patient that does not drink, especially in a hot, humid atmosphere like in that time, he will lose excess water in the form of excess sweating. He will lose water. Hypoglycemia is decreased glucose level below normal. As I described before, glucose is the main fuel for the brain and for the muscles.
Mm-hmm.
So this patient will be dizzy, lack of concentration, lassitude, fatigue, bound heart.
Mm-hmm. Maybe would there be any shortness of breath or anything?
Yeah,
like this?
Irritable, mm-hmm. with headache. This person have a hypoglycemic attack and he must end his fasting by 10 to 30 grams of glucose, 2 or 3 candies, 1 tablespoonful of honey or jam or things like that, and he must check his sugar regularly, even during fasting.
They have the painless test now.
Yeah, self-monitoring.
So you can go ahead and you can do that without any complications at all, right?
No, now it's a part of diabetic management. Is the self-monitoring. The patient must monitor himself.
All the time?
Yeah. He may not be able to reach his doctor now, but he is able to test his blood sugar now, and his doctor must prepare him how to deal with emergency situations till he can go to hospital or find his doctor.
Now, would you exclude from fasting those who have an unstable angina or uncontrollable hypertension?
Yeah. Any disease, complicated, or any disease that is dependent on regular medications may endanger the life of the patient if he is not able to take his medication. So if any patient is dependent on regular medications and his life will be endangered if these medications are prevented or postponed, he must not fast.
He must not fast at all.
Yeah.
With any medications, regardless of insulin or anything
whatever,
for the liver, anything like this,
yeah.
If it's going to be a life or death situation, they should just avoid that then.
Yes.
Are there any known side effects to fasting Ramadan with diabetes?
No, it's the hypoglycemia and dehydration you pointed it. Otherwise, in some cases, if some fasting diabetics are dehydrated and practice some vigorous physical activity just before iftar, at the end of the day, where the dehydration is at its most, they may develop some thrombotic manifestations. DVT, deep venous thrombosis of the lower limbs, like things like that.
Just like this. With this, we're going to go ahead and we're going to take a quick break, and we'll be back in a couple of minutes. I'm Ismaeel Chartier, and this is Dr. Hamdi Hassan, professor of internal medicine, the tropics, and Ain Shams University. Assalamu alaikum.
Marriage or divorce?
What's Islamic ruling?
Nikah.
Solution or problem? Heaven or hell?
There is a misconception.
You choose. Beauty, wealth, family status, virtue. Decide what you want. Decide your choice. Be sad or be happy. It's your choice. Join Dr. Zakir Naik in Better Half or Bitter Half every Sunday at 6:30 p.m. and repeat telecast at 9:30 a.m. Saudi Arabia on Peace TV.
If I were to ask you about the life of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, about the incidents that occurred before his prophethood and in Mecca and in Medina, about the names of his loved ones and his wives and his children, how much would we be able to know? How many incidents have we memorized? Brothers and sisters, isn't it more important that we study the seerah of the most important human being who ever walked the face of this earth? Join me, your host Yasir Qadhi, as we discuss the most important biography of the most illustrious human being that ever lived, the seerah of our beloved Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Join Yasir Qadhi in Seerah of the Prophet, peace be upon him, every Monday at 3:30 p.m. and repeat telecast at 2 a.m. Saudi Arabia on Peace TV.
Assalamu alaikum and welcome back to Health and Islam. I'm Ismaeel Chartier, as always your host, and with me is Dr. Hassan Hamdi, Professor of Internal Medicine of the Tropics at Ain Shams University. We are discussing a topic of great importance to Muslims who have diabetes, what are the requirements for fasting medically for them, if they can or if they can't. But as always, we suggest that if you have diabetes and as a Muslim, you should seek the advice of your own physician before fasting. You might find information on here that's helpful, but seek the advice of your own physician. Would you agree with this?
Yeah, I agree very much. This is what we call is life-saving.
Exactly. Now, who would you medically allow to reap the benefits? You said people who had diet issues, not a big problem. You would let them fast with no problem whatsoever. Or someone who had pre-diabetes, would you let them fast the month of Ramadan?
Yeah, pre-diabetics. Obese persons are advised to fast. But I want to emphasize that how a person, a diabetic person, who will fast, arrange his meals.
This is very important.
This is very important. To prevent his glucose from going up after iftar and from going down during fasting. Now, usually we advise the diabetic patient to have regular meals at short intervals. This cannot be done in Ramadan. So we advise a diabetic person who will fast to eat iftar as soon as azan.
And this is the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When you hear the Allahu Akbar of the azan, you break your fast.
Yes. And this must be a light meal, some vegetable soup, some sugary fluid, not too much. And then you want to pray, you go to pray. And this is also Sunnah Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. After praying, he will eat his main dish, which must contain carbohydrates in the form of rice, macaroni, or bread like that, mm-hmm. vegetables, some boiled animal protein, for example, meat or poultry, chicken, and some fresh fruits, one or two only.
A couple, like two or three dates.
Yeah. At midnight, he must have a snack. Sahur must be delayed till before azan at dawn.
Which is also the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to delay the whole.
Yes. And this delayed sahur, as if he is taking his breakfast somewhat earlier. So this may support his blood glucose throughout fasting.
Hmm. And what do you recommend they eat for zuhur? Something high in protein, something high in carbohydrates? Like an oatmeal or, you know, barley or something like this, something that'll help them get through the day?
I will advise this, but I strongly advise against fats. Fats are very detrimental for health. It provides so much calories. It adds weight. It affects vessels. I advise diabetics to eat carbohydrates. To eat carbohydrates, I repeat, to eat carbohydrates. Diabetic must eat rice, macaroni, bread, potatoes, sweet potatoes. They give their glucose in the body slow release. They give sense of satiety for a long
and
time.
And they make you feel like you're very, very full when you eat carbohydrates. Yeah. Small amount of carbohydrates makes you feel like you've eaten a large meal.
Yes. 60% of the food of diabetics must be carbohydrates.
For suhoor and for iftar?
Yeah.
This makes a lot of sense. Now, you said you would encourage overweight diabetics to fast.
Yeah.
Is this because the fasting process would help them, inshallah, to ahla, lose weight and to make it less stressful on their bodies to lose this
yeah,
weight?
Yeah, not only to lose weight, but it gives some rest to their gastrointestinal tract, which is overcrowded all over the year. Not only to control their diabetes, but losing weight will improve their lipid profile, their hepatic condition, their joint, the burden of the weight on this joint. It will prevent dyspnea. It will prevent skin inflammations due to friction between skin flexures. Mm-hmm. So fasting is very important for all their body systems.
Now, I read I kind of made up, actually, a pre-Ramadan checklist for doctors and patients. Now, if we could, I'd like to go through these quickly, inshallah, and see what you recommend with these. There needs to be, before you can fast Ramadan, there needs to be an assessment of your physical well-being.
Yeah.
To make sure you're able to do it, right?
Yeah. You must check weight. Mm-hmm. Blood sugar, both fasting and postprandial. Postprandial, I mean 2 hours after a meal, after his regular meal. Lipid profile, cholesterol and triglycerides, renal functions, uric acid, which is a reflection of the protein metabolism in the body. Creatinine is a measure of renal function, which may be affected in diabetics. Knowing his cardiac condition, if he is ischemic, if he has an unstable angina and things like that, before Ramadan fasting.
Assess metabolic control.
Yeah. What you call assessment of metabolic control is what I describe in details.
Those things exactly.
Yeah, carbohydrates, sugars, proteins, lipids. This is a metabolic control.
Okay. Adjustment of his diet to make that you've just described earlier. He has to eat suhoor late and eat iftar quickly, right as the adhan is called. And also, do you have to adjust the diet before the fast? Do you have to get them ready for it or no?
Yeah, you have to adjust the diet, but strict regulations and strict amounts is not practical. Over 25 years experience in treating patients, we have the most important cause of failure of medical treatment is that patient non-adherence to diet and non-adherence to treatment. Mm-hmm. And this non-adherence is really because what we call poor patient compliance. You give your patients instruction that he cannot follow.
Make it too hard on
him. Not correct. So it is advised not to advise your patient, but to hear from your patient his own system. At what time he wakes up, at what time he takes his breakfast, at what time he his lunch, what's the main components of his meals, what's his daily activities, where he get down, where he get his snack, where he get... And then you adjust... And
then you modify his own behavior.
On his own behavior. Because we know our aim of treatment in medicine is not to lengthen life. We cannot. Quantity of life is predetermined from God. No. Then what we are interested in is what we call quality of life. Not how long you live, but
how good is the life.
Yeah, how this life. Mm-hmm. Quality of life, to be adjusted, you must perform your all physical, mental, psychological, sexual, daily activity. So it is the job of the treating physician to adjust his regimen for his patient life for better quality of life.
Mm. That pretty much covers everything I have on this list. It's adjustment of the drug regimen, encouragement to continue physical activity or to start physical activity, and then to recognize the warning signs of dehydration and glaucoma, which is basically things that we've already discussed. We already discussed the nutritional requirements for those who fast with diabetics, that 60% of their diet needs to be of carbohydrates. Now, this goes against a lot of the leanings in the West to have a high protein diet and to cut the carbs out.
No. High protein diet in diabetics may precipitate so many complications. May precipitate gouty attacks, increasing uric acid. Mm-hmm. May precipitate complications in the kidney, especially called nephropathy or derangement of renal functions. So you don't advise high protein for all patients. If a patient is wasting with negative nitrogen balance, mm-hmm. loss of muscle mass, liability to infection, you may advise high protein. Mm-hmm. After surgery, you may advise high protein. But in patients with renal impairment or gouty arthritis, of associated diabetes and hepatic diseases where high protein may induce hepatic coma, you must be cautious. You don't give high protein. In general, the human body needs 1 gram of protein per kilogram body weight. Hmm. You need 60% carbohydrate, about 20-25 of fats, not more than 15% of your total calorie intake of protein.
Hmm. I read that the fats that we intake should be of essential fats like omega-3s. Is this true with the intake of fat for diabetics also?
Diabetics or non-diabetics, the fats are classified into what's called saturated fats and polyunsaturated fats. The polyunsaturated fats are healthy, are protective, are required. For example, omega-3, which is cod liver oil or halibut liver oil, that's very much advised for diabetics and non-diabetics, overweight, obese,
everybody.
to take this. Now, the concept of diabetes has changed. The whole world now speaks about what we call metabolic syndrome. Mm-hmm. Metabolic syndrome is really a thing that correlates things we realize them as a separate entities. Obesity, hypertension, dyslipidemia, diabetes, hepatomegaly, they were formerly seen as separate entities. But now the term metabolic syndrome correlates all of these. So the combination of these is usually present together, and they must be adjusted all together.
So it's unusual to find a skinny, an underweight diabetic. Most of the time you find an overweight diabetic.
We don't want this or that. Both are complicated patients.
What are the exercise requirements for a fasting diabetic? Like, what we've come to learn by doing the show is that exercise helps almost everything.
Yeah.
Stress relief, everything. What are exercise requirements for
the
diabetics?
Exercise requirements usually for the diabetics, especially in fasting, must be not vigorous, not very violent. Walking, jogging, swimming, ride the bicycle.
Mm-hmm. Just like walking from your house to the masjid.
Yeah.
Maybe praying tarawiyah.
Yeah, but not weightlifting. Yeah, not wrestling.
I don't think even non-diabetics would want to do this during Ramadan. You're fasting and you're like, should I go wrestle somebody?
Yeah.
What should the patient do for like a post-Ramadan visit? Do they do a post-Ramadan checkup with their physician? Say you give a patient the all clear to fast, and he monitors himself all through Ramadan and he has no complications. At the end of fasting Ramadan, he should make an appointment to go see you to make sure that, because he didn't notice anything, doesn't mean nothing happened.
Principally, he self-monitored himself all Ramadan. Mm-hmm. By the dipsticks. Okay? If he reported any change in his blood glucose, either hypoglycemia or hyperglycemia, he must contact his doctor immediately. If an attack of hypoglycemia occurred at any day, he must end his fasting. Okay? Mm-hmm. After Ramadan, he must be rechecked, especially before feast. Mm-hmm. Feast in Islam does not mean eating. Mm-hmm. But in Islam, but the traditions, feast is kahk, which is very high in fat, very high in sugar. Mm-hmm. And the patient who was exposed to hypoglycemia during fasting may be exposed to hyperglycemia
after fasting.
After fast.
Ah, so he needs to check for this.
Yeah.
I want to thank you very much for coming and talking to us about this important subject of fasting during Ramadan. And this concludes our episode of Health in Islam. I'm Ismaeel Chartier, and our guest, who we're very thankful for, was Dr. Hassan Hamdi, Professor of Internal Medicine of the Tropics at Vinesham University. Until next time, Assalamu alaikum.